Hi, everyone. I'm Uni Ravindranathan, and I lead program management for the team that builds XAML tools in Visual Studio and Blend. Today, I'm going to demo some of the awesome features we are introducing in Visual Studio 2013 and Blend for Visual Studio 2013 that make it really easy for you to build awesome Windows Store apps using XAML. Visual Studio 2013 introduces a number of new project and item templates that make it easy to build various kinds of apps like Grid and Hub. Of course, there is the blank app if you are the ninja developer that wants to sort of build everything from scratch. But if you wanted to get started on an existing common Windows 8.1 UX paradigm, there is the Hub template that's new for XAML developers. Let's go ahead and build and run the Hub app without making any changes. So there's the basic Hub app. It has a bunch of sections. The content is data bound. You can click on a particular item, view details. So these templates make it really easy for you to get started building your first Hub app in Visual Studio 2013. Let's take a look at some of the features we're adding in Visual Studio 2013 to make it really productive for you to use the XAML editor. The very first feature we're going to show you is GoToDefinition. VS 2013 now supports GoToDefinition from anywhere in your markup. So in this case, I have a sample XAML file that has a collection view source, which is data bound. So it's bound to the static resource and model. To navigate to the actual resource where the model object is coming from, I can just right click on it and hit GoToDefinition or the very familiar F12 key, and we will take you to anywhere in XAML where that particular resource is coming from. In this case, it's coming from app.xaml, and we have taken you to right into app.xaml where the resource is defined. You can also right-click on any type, be that in your project or a platform type, and hit go to definition. It will take you to the actual code file where you declare the particular type. So in VS 2013, we have made it really easy for you to navigate between XAML files, code files, and vice versa. We make it really seamless to transition and inspect your code and make edits to that code. Another cool feature of the XAML editor is its ability to handle nested comments. So in this case, I have a style, and that style has a couple of comments within it. Let's say my goal was to comment out the entire style because I'm not really using it anywhere in my XAML. I can simply select the entire style definition, right click, and hit either use the Control KC gesture or go to the toolbar and comment out the style. VS is intelligent enough to handle the nested comments case and comment out the files, the various lines as necessary. Moving on, the next feature I'm going to show you is the ability to automatically complete tags as you rename them. So in this case, I want to rename the viewbox tag to something else. So let's say I wanted to rename it to border. And you see that as soon as I'm doing the rename, the end tag is automatically getting updated as well. So it made it really easy to sort of update tags in your XAML editor. The XAML editor in Visual Studio 2013 introduces a number of new IntelliSense features. And a couple of my favorite features are IntelliSense for data binding and resources. So like we were seeing before, let's say I wanted to sort of type the XAML and wanted to specify the static resource that was to be used here. Let's go and invoke IntelliSense. You notice that Visual Studio is now intelligent enough to show you all resources that are applicable to that particular scope, no matter where they are coming from. We correctly figure out if they're coming from the system styles or if they're coming from the application object or any one of these resource dictionaries, and we'll show you all of the resources that are applicable. Let's say I wanted to complete a binding expression in my XAML. In Visual Studio 2013, as you type your markup, if we were able to correctly figure out the data context, no matter if it's defined local to the element or it's inherited, we'll show you full IntelliSense for completing the binding. Moreover, just like before, you can right-click on any binding expression, hit go to definition, and we'll take you to the actual data model class where the particular property is defined. So to summarize, the XAML editor in Visual Studio introduces a number of productivity features, right from IntelliSense for data binding and resources, navigation across code and XAML, as well as a number of productivity features like the ability to comment out nested comments, close completing tags, close ending tags, and so on and so forth. Now that we have seen some of the nifty features that the XAML editor in Visual Studio 2013 brings to the table, let's also see some of the designer features that we have in Visual Studio 2013's design surface for XAML apps. So in this case, I have the Hub app, and the very first thing I wanted to call out is we have full support, first-class support, design time support for a bunch of these controls. So as you can see, as I'm selecting different Hub sections, Visual Studio is actually previewing the right section. I can right-click on a particular hub section and choose to edit it. So in this case, let's say I wanted to change the text blocks, font, or something like that. I can easily go into the hub section that defines the particular text block and make a change there. The device panel in Visual Studio 2013 has a new feature that allows you to see the entire hub control at the same time. So if I open the device panel, there is an option in here called Auto. And when I select it, let me just fit the contents to screen. I can see the entire hub section at the same time. Super useful if I wanted to make edits that sort of span multiple sections. In a previous version, with a similar scenario, you'd have to sort of select the section, copy contents, scroll the other section into view and make an edit. In VS 2013, because of this feature, you can see controls that span multiple pages very easily on the design surface and make quick edits. Another control that we have added really good support for in VS 2013 is the app bar. Let's go ahead and configure an app bar. To configure an app bar, you just right-click on the page control, either on the page top app bar or bottom app bar property, choose to add a command bar, and start adding buttons to sort of configure. So in this case, let's say I wanted to add a couple of buttons to the left side of the app bar and a couple of buttons to the right side. I'd right-click on the command bar dot primary commands property and choose to add an app bar button that adds the app bar to the right side of the app bar button. Similarly, I could right-click to on the primary secondary commands property and choose to add an app bar button on the left-hand side. I can bring up the property inspector, and we have support for configuring your icons. So in this case, let's say I wanted to select a particular Sego UI symbol font icon. So let's say I wanted to select the four bars. It's as simple as that to create and configure an app bar. Let me just zoom in a little bit so you can see what really happened there. So Visual Studio 2013 makes it really easy for you to work with a good number of Windows 8.1 controls, new controls that are introduced, such as the hub and the app bar. Let's switch over to the same project in Blend and take a look at some of the design-focused features that we've added in Blend for Visual Studio 2013. One of the features I really like is the concept of rulers and guides. Guides make it really easy for you to precisely align content across container boundaries. If you're a XAML developer, you know that you're dealing with a hierarchy of containers, and it's really hard to get your layout just about right so that things align correctly in your app. To create a guide, you would use the ruler area in Blend and just drag the guide out. Notice that as you drag the guide out, we show you how many pixels the guide is relative to either the left or the top or the bottom or the right of the page. In this case, it's 73 pixels from the left of the page, but what I really want is the guide to be 80 pixels relative to the left of the page. Let's go ahead and make it 80 pixels. Let's also create a guide from the top of the page. Let's say 100 pixels from the top of the page, and another one that's about 100 pixels relative to the bottom of the page. To anchor a guide relative to the bottom, you just bring up the context menu for the guide and just select the bottom alignment option, and then configure your guide to be, let's say, 100 pixels. So to summarize, rulers and guides make it really easy for you to create your design guidelines and at the same time create layouts that are pixel perfect as specified by your design team. In Blend for Visual Studio 2013, we have also made a number of improvements that make it really easy for you to style controls. One of the features is the ability to edit a style right in context of the place where the style is getting used in, no matter where the style is coming from. To show this feature in action, let's use our hub app and navigate to a section that contains a data template. So in this case, you notice that there is a grid view control that has a specified set of data templates. Let's go ahead and edit the hub section. And let's go ahead and edit one of the data templates. Let's say my goal was to create a data template that I'm sharing across multiple pages. So the thing you do here is to take the data template and put that into a common place like your app.xaml. Let's go ahead and make that change. So edit additional templates, edit item template, edit a copy, and I'm going to select app.xaml. Notice what happens as soon as I make this change. Nothing really changes in terms of how your design surface is presented to you. If you open app.xaml, it'll contain the data template that you just copied from the hub page into app.xaml, but the edits that you're making to the data template are completely contextual relative to the hub page where the data template was actually getting used in. So Blend for Visual Studio 2013 makes it really easy for you to style controls in context of the places where they are getting used in. Now that we've seen some of the design features, let me walk you through some of my favorite code editing features in Visual Studio 2013. Let's switch back to Visual Studio 2013. What I'm going to do is show you the feature that we call internally as Peek that allows you to quickly see the code no matter where it's coming from. Just like we saw for the style editing feature, VS has some really cool code editing features as well. Let's go ahead and press the Alt key and F12. Notice how the definition of the type that was in a completely different file is now shown contextually in context of the page that I'm trying to make the edit. So in this case, movie item is coming from a completely different file, movieitem.cs, and I'm seeing it in context of my file main moviesviewmodel.cs. When I make a change, and you can edit these files as well. So let's say I'm going to make a change. Notice how Visual Studio opened a tab that's sort of dirty. If you switch to that tab, you see like the change is now committed as well. So we've made it really easy in Visual Studio 2013 to make edits to a code file that come from anywhere in your project. Another code editor feature that I really like in Visual Studio 2013 is the ability to see references to types and functions where they are defined. So in this case, see the type movie item has this annotation on top called 20 references. Let's see what happens when I click that. Notice how we have now shown you all of the references to movie item, no matter where they are sort of coming from. Let's go ahead and click on one of these things, and we jump right to the place where that particular reference comes from. This makes it really easy for you to know if a particular type or a reference is used and navigate to the usage of that particular type or method or whatever is that reference. Let's go ahead and debug this application to see some of the new debugging features we have introduced in this release. As soon as the debugger starts, I have a breakpoint that I've set that gets hit. But I wanted to highlight a new feature, the tasks window. If you have done async programming of late, it was pretty hard to sort of get, you know, an idea of when a task is getting executed, what's queued up, and so on and so forth. For Windows Store apps in VS 2013, you have a new window called the tasks window that shows all of the tasks that are either active, are being, you know, awaited on, or are blogged, and so on and so forth. So the tasks window in VS 2013 makes it really easy for you to visualize all of the outstanding and in-progress tasks when you're sort of running some async code. Let's keep debugging to see the next feature in action. I'm going to go ahead and click on an item and navigate to a page and hit back. Now I have a breakpoint set in my code just to demonstrate the feature. Let's go ahead and hit F10 to navigate to the next statement. The feature I want to show you is if I switch to the autos window, we now show you return value of functions, in this case, this.frame.navigate, in the auto window without you having to create a local variable and cast the function to that particular local variable to inspect it. I can also go to the immediate window and type a special keyword, return value, and I see the evaluated value of the return value of the function in my immediate window. Super useful if you're debugging functions that have meaningful return values, but you don't really care about the return values as much. At the same time, during debugging, you want to have a quick inspection. Let's continue with our debugging. So I'm going to hit F5, go back to the app, click on a particular movie item, and use the app bar to invoke the pin to start command. Notice in the call stack, what really is happening is we are executing a function asynchronously, and we can see the full call stack. So in this case, you can see that Visual Studio 2013 has figured out that you're sort of resuming an async function, and we have shown you the full call stack leading up to that particular async function that's getting executed. Again, super helpful if you're debugging async code. To summarize some of the debugging features, we have made it really easy in Visual Studio 2013 to debug asynchronous code, inspect return values, and a few of the other features that I'm not showing here, like being able to edit and continue 64-bit code and so on and so forth. Let's also take a look at some of the new diagnostic tooling we have built in Visual Studio 2013. To bring up the diagnostic tools, you go to the Analyze menu and bring up the Performance and Diagnostics Hub. The Performance and Diagnostics Hub is your one-stop shop to view all of the diagnostic tools that you can use for your application. I'm going to show a couple of these tools in action. Let's first take a look at the XAML UI responsiveness tool, a new tool we've built for Windows Store apps in Visual Studio 2013. Let's go ahead and select that tool and hit start. The VS Profiler is now launching up, and it's collecting a bunch of data around the running characteristics of your app. Let's go ahead and navigate a few pages. Let's switch back to Visual Studio and stop collecting. Now Visual Studio is doing an analysis of all of the information that it has collected, and it presents you with a nice visualization of various things that could potentially be bottlenecks in your app. So you could select a particular area and inspect more details. So in this case, it's pretty evident that this particular control is taking up about 114 milliseconds of the time that's required to sort of render that particular page, and I could make some performance optimizations based on this data. Similarly, we show you the time it takes to sort of parse a particular file during a particular range selection. That again allows you to make optimizations to your code to defer the parsing or load content asynchronously and things like that. So you always guarantee a very optimal frame rate experience for your application. Another diagnostic tool that we have in VS 2013 is the energy consumption tool that allows you to examine where energy is consumed in your application. Let's go ahead and select the energy consumption tool, hit start, and do the same thing we did before. Let's go ahead and navigate across a couple of pages, switch back to Visual Studio, and stop collecting the data. Notice how Visual Studio presents the energy usage of your application in a way that sort of allows you to figure out how to make the right trade-offs between battery, power and display, or for that matter, networking. If you go ahead and select a particular subsection of your timeline, you see that in this particular profile, about 41% of the time was spent in your potentially displaying, you know, data to the user on your screen. 51% of the time was spent on the CPU doing work, and about 7% of the time was spent doing network I/O. Probably you're fetching data from the network in terms of images or data or something like that. So the energy profiler makes it really easy for you to visualize energy consumption characteristics of your app and sort of make the right trade-offs between network, display, and other factors like network, display, and CPU. Thanks, everyone. I hope you find some of the new features we have in Visual Studio and Blend make it really easy to build Windows 8.1 store apps in XAML that look and behave great and that your customers would love. Thank you.